Coming up next on Central Illinois World War II Stories, we'll feature an interview with Jill Pitts Knappenberger of Champaign.
Chicago way. He had a boogie style that no one else could play. He was the top man at his craft. But then his number came up and he was gone with the draft. He's in the army now, a blowing reveille. He's the boogie woogie bugle boy of Company B.
Former American Red Cross volunteer Jill Pitts Knappenberger recalls her service to the military in World War II. From 1943 to 45, Jill drove a 2.5-ton refitted military truck filled with refreshments like coffee, donuts, candy, and music.
Well, they just loved our being there and serving them coffee and donuts. And it was one of the best jobs I ever did because it meant so much to them, and we were doing something that nobody else could do.
Her mission?
We're bringing cheer, mainly, and hometown spirits to these boys. And they were glad from the break. They've been on the line in combat, and it's just relaxation. We were working with the greatest people on earth, the American GI.
This traveling symbol of warmth and recreation, known as the clubmobile, was conceived by Harvey Gibson, commissioner of the American Red Cross in Britain. Mr. Gibson wanted to extend hospitality service to soldiers fighting on the front lines of battle. Women interested in serving as a Red Cross recreation worker had to meet physical and educational requirements. After pre-screening and operations training, the women were sent to brighten the spirits of battle-fatigued soldiers waging war against the Germans.
When they first came up to meet us, it was a joyful thing, cheery. And they'd want to, where are you from? Oh, so-and-so's from there. And of course, we did have these registers alphabetized by the states. And the GI's first thing they want was to see that and go to their state and look through there and look for the name of a buddy. And that we quite often did get them together. We had 75 RPM records that we played and a PA system. They loved it. And everybody looked forward to mail. It meant an awful lot. Sometimes the field artillery boys would let us pull the lanyards on the guns that we could shoot the Germans. I've done that more than once. We'd go out to the different divisions with Corps. In the meantime, before we go, we'd make all these thousands of donuts and coffee. And it was a new adventure for us to go where all these different units were. But we never were with any long enough to become close friends. Things were moving pretty fast.
A crew of three clubmobile girls, as they were known, often traveled with infantry combat units to isolated areas.
Each unit was individual. Ours was the one farthest advanced and got into the most trouble. Helen Anderson, Phyllis McLaughlin, and Jill Pitts. We were the only three women actually caught in the Battle of Bulge.
Unlike her female counterparts, Jill knew how to drive and repair the heavyweight clubmobile. Her keen abilities were recognized, and she soon began teaching other Red Cross girls how to drive.
They brought in two girls that had superior driving records, and I was one of them, to teach the new girls coming from the USA how to drive these things.
During a lull between the exchange of enemy fire, Jill traveled to an area where her twin brother Jack, a battery commander with the 106th Army Division, was embedded with his troops. She was planning a party and wanted to introduce Jack to Helen, her friend from the clubmobile.
That was a Saturday night, December 16th. It was her birthday, and I wanted her to meet my twin brother Jack. See, I had seen Jack just 2 days before. We'd had it all arranged. It was going to be a party that night. Well, that didn't happen. When we got there, we found we were cut off and surrounded. There was very little communication because the enemy had cut the communication lines. There was no ammunition coming in, no food. We're just isolated in this little pocket. We had an assimilated rank of being captain if we were captured. So that was quite a shock, because at that time the field director came up and told me that my twin brother had been killed that morning trying to help some of his men. And that's devastating. But you keep going. It's not like here, you're gonna go home and cry on your mother's shoulder. You can't do that. And this was part of what we signed up for. We didn't expect it, but we tried to keep people happy there and spread the cheer that we could. And we were there for 8 days before the 82nd Airborne came in. Then they told us to pack a musette, which is a little shoulder bag, with what we wanted to carry out with us. Put an incendiary bomb in the clubmobile, because we weren't going to have the Krauts have our supplies. In the meantime, the 20th of December, I think it was, we opened our Christmas presents that came from home, because we didn't know if we were going to get them open. And we were prepared to crawl through the lines and just waiting there, and they were to inform us, and then they came back and said one road had been opened briefly and we could drive out. We'd be led out by a Jeep with a colonel and a captain, two GIs. Of course, I did the driving, and I'm following these taillights on this Jeep, not very far behind, and all of a sudden those taillights disappeared, so I stopped. We walked up the road a little way, and our leading Jeep had run into the back end of 2.5-ton trucks bringing in ammunition. The Jeep was total. The colonel was out unconscious on the pavement. And of course, this is the very fine single line of escape, so we had to pick up the colonel and put him in the clubmobile, push the Jeep off the road because we couldn't have it blocked. It's the only road of escape, and put Phyllis and the captain and the two GIs in the back of the clubmobile. There was a great deal of confusion then. Vehicles coming and going. We didn't know where we were to go except to get out of where we were. And we were directed to a forward CP command post and spent the night there. Till they came at 4 o'clock in the morning, get out of here as fast as you can because we've lost the only roadblock between us and the enemy.
After her escape from the Bulge, Jill wrote a letter to her family. With measured words, she carefully concealed the news of her brother's death.
I was sworn by the Army not to mention that he'd been killed because they were to be the first to notify the next of kin. I couldn't mention it for 30 days, so that was one of the worst letters I ever had to write. I could write and say I'd seen him, you know, and I did take some pictures.
As she left Germany at the end of the war with her camera still intact, Jill photographed scenes, morbid scenes of the concentration camps.
We couldn't believe that one human being would treat another human being with such horror. And then I did see the lamp that the commandant's wife had made from the skin of some of the inmates there. And there were piles, 4 feet high, of just bones. We just couldn't believe. Well, it's almost like you can't believe that what the terrorists did to the Twin Towers.
Let not the defeatists tell us that it is too late. It will never be earlier.
I'm a Lutheran.
Tomorrow will be later than today.
We need more peace.